Okay, welcome back. We'll continue with now assembling our element level matrix vector representations into our global matrix vector weak form. All right. At the end of the last segment, we had obtained a representation, okay, so for the following integral, right? You probably have this on your notes. I'm just taking it down. I'm just copying it down from my saved slides here. Right, we said that we considered a specific example where we said that that local degrees of freedom 1, 4, 5, and 8 were the ones that lay on the face that coincided, the face of the element that coincided with the Neumann boundary. Okay, so those, so we wrote that out in the following form. And for the resulting vector that we have here, the column vector, we said the first element was non-zero, the next two would be zero, the fourth would be non-zero, the fifth would also be non-zero, right? The sixth and seventh would be zero, and the eighth would be non-zero. Now, what I'm going to do is, this is an example, right? This is an example where local degrees of freedom, 1, 4, 5, and 8 are the ones that belong to that set, okay? What I'm going to do is just to have common notation. Observe that this thing can of course always be written as minus C E transpose, right? The row vector of all those degrees of freedom. F J E. Okay. All we need to observe is that in this column vector F J sub E, some of the contributions are zero. Right? These are the ones corresponding to the degrees of freedom that do not lie on that particular element face coinciding with the Neumann boundary. The rest of them are in general non-zero. Okay? So, the reason I'm doing this is because this is what we want to use when we pull together all the other integrals that we've developed over previous segments to represent, all the different representations we've developed for the other integrals in the weak form, okay? So what we want to do is use in the following, right? We now have a way to write the left-hand side, okay, as a sum over E of terms of the form C E transpose K E DE. Okay, we derived this a few segments ago, equal to sum over E, C E transpose F internal E. And now this new term that we've developed here, right? This is again a sum over elements, but I'm not going to write, I'm not going to say that this sum for the traction term extends over all the elements, right? Instead, adopting the notation that we had in the previous segment to designate the degrees of freedom lying on the Neumann boundary, I'm going to say that E here belongs to a set E sub n, which I think we actually already have defined, right? The elements corresponding to elements which have some part of their surface, of their faces, lying on the Neumann boundary. Okay, so we have E belongs to this script En. C E transpose F J E. Okay, the other sums run over all the elements, E going from 1 to NEL, E going from 1 to NEL. All right. Okay. At this point, I want to bring to your attention the fact that we can just multiply this through by minus, right? By minus 1, changing all the signs so that we get something that we may feel a little more comfortable about. Okay, so we basically transfer the minus sign onto the forcing function. And this brings us to another little detail which it is useful to bring up at this point before we go ahead to assembly. Okay, and I'm referring to the fact that the way we've set things up here, that term has a negative sign. Okay. So I'm going to refer to that and I'm going to do that in an aside. I need to make an aside here. Okay. Essentially, the form of the equations that we have, okay, the form of the equations that we have is obtained from the strong form, right, going all the way back to the strong form, where the strong form had the following appearance, right? Minus divergence, the flux equals a forcing function, okay? Now, this particular form had been adopted by me in order to be consistent, right, to be consistent with the way heat conduction or diffusion equations are typically written in the field of numerical methods that treats these types of problems, okay? However, it's probably useful to also recognize that this is a steady state equation. Okay, arrived at from an equation of another type, right? Now, let us suppose that whatever quantity that is undergoing transport, like for instance, the temperature, right? If one were to include the rate of the temperature, right, that is go away from steady state, but really look at how the steady state problem arises, one would get an equation of the following form. One would have C time derivative of U equals minus divergence of J minus F. Okay? Where this would be, if you were thinking of the temperature problem, for instance, right, the heat conduction problem, this left-hand side would be the rate of change of temperature right? And the statement here would be that the rate of change of temperature was driven by this term, which we have already previously observed to be the total influx of heat into a little elemental volume, right? Instead of total, let me call it net heat influx. Okay? Right, so that is one way in which the temperature rises, simply by heat being transported into a little volume. And then this term would correspond to the local heating. Local may be distributed Okay, what we did was start out with this, what we did could have been arrived at and properly is arrived at by starting out with this time-dependent form, right? So this is time-dependent form, right? And saying that, well, we have steady state and therefore we set the time rate of temperature equal to zero. Okay? And then, of course, that we would have been left with the right-hand side equals zero, which we would have rearranged to the form presented here. Okay? All right? And this is the form that we worked with. Okay? But you observe that when viewed in the larger setting of a time-dependent or a transient problem, the local distributed heating, or alternately, if you're looking at a diffusion problem, the local supply of mass, okay, for the way we're writing things out, is properly minus of F. Okay? Right? It's just a matter of the way we took the signs when we started out with the PDE in this form. All right? So, what this suggests is that if we look back to the equation that ended the previous slide, okay, it makes sense for us to simply flip the sign on the forcing term, okay, and we'll give it a different symbol, right, and we'll, you know, that will be properly the forcing that is obtained from considerations of how the steady state PDE can be arrived at from the transient problem. Okay, so what we're going to do is redefine F bar equals minus F, right? And if you go back and redo all our derivation with just this little change, what we will see then is sum over E integral WHF dV integral over omega E of this, right? With the minus sign, okay, is of course integral sum over E integral over omega E WH F bar dV. Okay? And accordingly, the minus sign that showed up when I wrote out the weak form as a sum over elements, right? That the minus sign and the forcing term would be absorbed. Okay? So what I'm proposing is also to write now sum over E CE transpose KE DE equals what we have so far is this. I noticed I flipped the positions of this transpose and element here. Okay. CE transpose KE, CE transpose F internal E plus sum over E belonging to En C E transpose F J E, right? This is what we had at the end of two slides ago. What I'm proposing now is to replace this with sum over E C E transpose F bar internal E. Okay, right, where the association that we are making here is that now this is essentially equal to integral over omega E W H F bar dV. Okay? Right? When we do things this way, F bar turns out to be properly the forcing function that would make sense even in the case of a time dependent problem, which is something that we will go to. Okay, so for our purposes, there are no big changes. It's just a matter of flipping a sign on that term. Okay, and it actually makes everything consistent now with the time dependent case. Okay, so if we agree with if we agree about this little change, we can now go on, and essentially we will now go to our step of finite element assembly. Okay, so the assembly of global finite element equations, right, in matrix vector form. Okay, all right, and you know very well how this proceeds. Essentially, it's a matter of looking at each of our element level contributions, such as this one, right, or this one, and this one, and understanding how they map into the global vectors. Okay, this was relatively straightforward to do in the case of the 1D problem. It turns out to be a little more complicated in the case of the general three-dimensional problem. And what we have to grapple with here is the idea of mesh connectivity. Okay, so that is what we are going to look at now. Okay.